Welcome back to World War II TV and my prolonged absence because I was conducting the World War II TV April Normandy tour. If you're interested in October's tour, send me a message. Anyway, today's show is the first in an ongoing series I have called Churchill Reassessed, where we will analyse aspects of his career, focusing on World War II, of course. Walter Reid is a British historian whose latest book, Fighting Retreat, Churchill and India, is in the links below. I'm delighted to bring him in. Good evening, Walter. How are you today?
I'm very well, Paul. Good to be with you.
So how do you define yourself as a historian? Because you've written about the military aspects, political aspects. Do you have a particular label you like to ascribe yourself?
Well, I'm a recovering lawyer. I spent a lot of years as a lawyer and I escaped from that. I'm recovering now. My name is Walter. I'm a recovering lawyer. And the way I escaped from that was that I found myself writing a book about an uncle who had died of wounds following the Battle of Arras, 1917. And I was really just trying to do this for the benefit of my children or grandchildren or whatever, just to put down what I knew about him, because I realized that with me, a lot of memories would die. And I was the last kind of person who knew about the family law and the thing. So I wrote about it, meaning just to photocopy it and hand it to the family. But as I wrote it, I found myself putting him into his context, trying to explain why he was not an unusual man, except that he was like a lot of people who died in that war who were very unusual in what they did. And I was trying to explain the motivation of patriotism, duty, self-sacrifice, and so on. And having done that, I sent it to a number of professional historians that I happen to know of and said, anything I could do to make this better. And they were very nice. And it was very interesting to me that as historians, they were prepared to help another historian. If as a lawyer, I had written to another lawyer and said, can you help me here? They'd have told me to get lost or charged me for their time. Anyway, they all came back and said, yeah, this is good. It ought to be published. So the end of the story was I sent it to a publisher. It was published, and that led on to a number of books. I think I've now done 10 on aspects of British history, imperial policy, and 20th century wars. I've written before about Churchill, and I've written about the First World War at some length. So that's what I am, and that's how I came to be doing it. I'm not anything like as informed as many of your guests will be on the details of military history. It's the political aspect and the geopolitical aspect of it that really interests me.
Well, brilliant. Great instruction. And what we'll do, folks, is we're going to start. Walter's going to read a little bit of his book, and then he's going to give us a little sort of 20-minute sort of summary of Churchill's complicated and interesting and difficult relationship with India, and then I'll ask a few questions, and of course we'll take the questions from the viewers. So kind of over to you to summarize things for us.
Well, thanks, Paul. What I'll do is to read very briefly just the first chapter or two, indeed the first paragraph or two of the book, and then kind of explain what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. But just to set the scene, if I can just begin at the very beginning of the book. It starts, on the 18th of June, 1895, Winston Churchill, a junior officer in the 4th Hussars, sailed for Europe from Bombay, Mumbai. And that's a picture of him as he would have looked in that time. He cut an elegant figure in his cavalry uniform. He was good looking, his eyes blue, his hair ginger, his countenance distinctly boyish. Very different from the statue by Ivor Roberts Jones, which now stands in Parliament Square in London. In 2012, that iconic statue was sprayed with red paint to look as if red blood were emerging from Churchill's mouth, and a strip of grass, like a Mohican haircut, was placed on his head. 10 years later, 2022, in the course of Black Lives Matter protests, when Churchill was repeatedly accused of responsibility for the famine in Bengal of 1942-43, the statue was attacked again. And underneath the name Winston Churchill, the words is our racist with Gaul. But the statue of the man so often described as the savior of his country had to be created up for his protection. In 2021, at the Cambridge College that's named after Churchill and that constitutes the National and Commonwealth Memorial to him, there was a year-long series of discussions entitled Churchill, Race and Empire. The theme wasn't really whether or not Churchill had been a racist. That was pretty much taken for granted. The conclusion was that the British Empire was the blueprint for Nazism, that the Holocaust was, quote, not an outlier at all, that Churchill's views on race were much the same as the Nazis, and that Churchill had facilitated the Bengal Famine. Why has his image so changed? Was the hero of 1940 to 45 the savior of his country, a racist enemy of India? That is what this book is about. So there you are. That is what this book is about. How did I come to it? Well, one of my earlier books was called Keeping the Jewel in the Crown. And it's a study of British policy in relation to India from the reforms of 1917 to independence in 1947, exactly 30 years later. And I deal with British politicians and what they said about India and the impressions they gave to Indians about their plans for the subcontinent. And I was horrified, really, that there was so much lying. Indians who had fought in the First World War, to such effect, were told that they would get their reward in due course, but it wasn't going to be quickly, and weasel words were used. Words that could mean one thing, but another. To the Indian politicians, the independence politicians, they thought Britain was promising early independence, position rather like the white dominions of Canada or Australia and so forth. But what the politicians and the viceroys actually meant was a very different kind of dominion, if a dominion at all, a dominion from which India, crucially, would not be able to withdraw, as the white dominions could. They could leave the Commonwealth, they could leave the empire when they wanted to, but India was never going to be in that sort of situation. It was a deplorable story, and obviously I encourage you to read the book for the larger picture. And in it, Churchill appears quite a bit. He appears at various stages, notably in the 1930s, when he and his group of backwoodsmen tried to defeat the Government of India Act of 1935, which was designed to bring India towards some sort of federal quasi-independent situation. He obstructed that, and perhaps we'll come back to talk more about that later, but he was intensely obstructive, negative, blinkered, hostile. And then again, it might have been the end of his career in 1935 because his position in India wasn't a popular one with the Conservative Party. But in 1940, as you know, he came back as Prime Minister. In 1939, indeed, he comes back as First Lord of the Admiralty. So he's able, between 1940 and 45, to continue this policy of obstructionism in relation to India's aspirations. So he was important in the story of these 30 years, but to preserve a sense of balance and proportionality, I couldn't concentrate on him unduly there. And the present book is an attempt to focus on him. I've written about him before, a book called Under Friendly Fire. It describes the opposition Churchill had to get past to get his strategy adopted in the Second World War. And I say in it that I regard him as a great man. A great man, particularly because of his magnanimity, his sense of humanity, his sense that human beings had an innate and worthwhile dignity of their own. And he was like that. He was, I still say, a liberal man and progressive man in any way, in many ways. And yet, in relation to India, he was anything but. And that really is what this book is about. Why was this man who was liberal to the colonies, to what were called the subject races in those days, why did he take the position he did in relation to India, and really only in relation to India? And this I found very fascinating. Just to explain why I say he was liberal in relation to the colonies and so on. In the beginning, the very beginning of his career, he was a junior minister at the colonial office. But the colonial secretary was in the House of Lords, couldn't appear in the Commons. So Churchill, although a fairly junior minister, had quite an important role in relation to the colonies, and he was liberal towards them. He thought the British Empire was a good thing because it brought civilization to starving nations, but he was conscious that much of what that involved was awful, and he thought it was awful, and he tried to alleviate that awfulness. So, for instance, in the First World, in the Boer War, he said, if I were a Boer, I would be fighting Britain too. He was very sympathetic to them. He fought, he was technically a journalist, but he fought in South Africa. He was taken prisoner, as you know, and by the Boers. But come the end of the war, he put out feelers. He tried to make friends with them. He tried to reconcile, and he had a key role actually in devising the constitution for the emerging South African dominion. Then again, at the end of the war, he's now Secretary of State, probably Secretary of State for the colonies, not a junior minister, but Secretary of State. And he finds himself with the responsibility for these new great chunks of empire. Because remember, Britain was at its biggest point in terms of the extent of our empire in 1922-23, when we got the mandates, as they were called, the responsibility for running chunks of the Ottoman Empire, Palestine and Transjordan, and what was then called Mesopotamia. Now, you might have thought, if you have the image of Churchill as an inveterate imperialist, I might have thought he'd be rubbing his hands and saying, great, we really are a top nation, we're bigger even than we were before the war. In fact, he couldn't wait to get shot of these places. He reckoned that the cost of maintaining them in terms of money and in terms of military effort wasn't justified. So he propelled them arguably into premature independence before they were ready to look after themselves. But he certainly wasn't rubbing his hands and saying, right, great, I'm all for empires. Similarly, he had also responsibility for Ireland. This is, we're just at the stage when the Republic of Ireland, the era of the Free State, is breaking away. And it was he who signed the constitution, the deal, the treaty that constituted the Free State. So unlike his father, who had said, Ulster will fight and Ulster will be right, Churchill propelled the Republic into independence. When he signed the treaty, he said to Michael Collins, who was signing for the Republic, I may be signing my political death warrant. Collins said, I may be signing my real death warrant. And Collins was indeed dead and in a ditch, a matter of months. And it might interest you and particularly your Indian listeners, Paul, to know that because of this, because of South Africa, because of the Middle East, because of Ireland, Stanley Baldwin, his boss throughout the 30s, very seriously considered appointing Churchill as Secretary of State for India, or even, incredible thought, as Viceroy. That's one of these blind alleys. We'll never know what would have happened. I tend to think Churchill was sobered by responsibility, and he might have been a liberal and progressive viceroy, who knows. But anyway, that's a blind alley. He didn't go down that route. And instead, he he found himself in opposition to the Indian proposals. From 1917, when you had the reforms of that year, India seemed to be poised at the top of a very long descent towards self-government of some sort. And after the First World War, when India had poured out blood and money, a great deal of money, to support the British war effort, Indians thought they would be rewarded by moving into independence like the White Dominions. In fact, as you know, what were called the Rowlatt Acts, the Black Acts, severely repressive legislation was brought in 1917, and there was a clampdown on any movement towards independence. But before I come on to on what Churchill did in 1930s and the 1940s, just let me add another example of his liberal approach. Was that in 1917, as you know, there was the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, when British troops fired on unarmed civilians in Jallianwala Bagh, an open square just outside Amritsar. Britain, it's usually known as the Amritsar massacre, in India, Jallianwala Bagh. And Churchill was Secretary of State for War at this point, and he had responsibility for dealing with General Dyer, the British general who had fired and directed his troops to fire without getting warning on these unarmed civilians. And there were very much two views in Dyer in Britain. There were those who thoroughly approved of him, thought that he was digging his heels in against left-wing descent into anarchy. He was upholding traditional values. He'd saved the Indian Empire. One of the newspapers collected a huge sum of money for him by subscription, and a sword of honor was presented to him. And in the House of Lords said, this is a good guy, and they voted in favor, they voted against the government's policy. The Conservative government had decided that Dyer had to be dismissed, put onto half pay. The House of Lords, although broadly overwhelmingly a Conservative, voted against that. In the Commons, Churchill had a difficult task to do. A lot of the people in the Commons were also pro-Dyer, but Churchill's speech is one of the best speeches he made, in my view. He begins quietly, forensically analysing the events that took place, and gradually building up to show how desperately evil the events had been. It was one of those speeches that carried one of these speeches that completely transformed the mood of the House. The Commons ended up voting for the government and agreeing with the disciplining of Dyer. That again was Churchill showing his good side, in my view.
And just before you carry on, you said the word liberal a couple of times. When we had our pre-chat this afternoon, we kind of brought up the idea of a changing understanding of terminology, and we're going to talk about historiography later, because the fact is that liberal meant something in the 1920s, it meant something when I was a young man in the 80s, it means something now, and the same applies to a lot of the language used when you discuss something like Churchill in India. So when you were researching your book and you're reading terms, how do you process what the term meant now, what it meant then, and kind of trying to make a sense of it?
Well, I think you have to, if you're going to be a historian, you've got to look at things in the historical context. You've got to work out what people meant by the words they used at the time they used them. You've then got to try to translate that into what you would say nowadays to convey the same point of view. As far as liberal, just for avoidance of any doubt, this is a small L. I'm not talking about the Liberal Party.
Yeah, of course.
Churchill did, of course, begin as liberal, moved to the... I've got them the wrong way around. Began as a Conservative, moved to the Liberal Party, and then came back, re-ratted, as he said, came back across the floor of the House, be a Conservative again. No, I'm using the word in a fairly loose sense of being in favor of looking after the interests of the underdog, looking after people who are aspiring to improve their political position. And Churchill did that. There's two little cameos, actually, I always think of when I'm thinking of Churchill. One, in the First World War, he had fought at the front in the First World War. He'd had a lot of his friends and relations killed in the war. He'd seen Britain brought close to defeat in the submarine blockade of 1917. Then a year later, the war is won, and Germany has been reduced, partly by starvation and the blockade, the Allied blockade on shipping. And you might have thought Churchill would be celebrating like Billy O, but the first thing he did was to say, I want to send a fat grain ship into Hamburg. His predominant reaction was of pity for the starving ordinary people in Germany. We might contrast that. I imagine we're going to talk at some stage about the Bengal Famine. So we just bear that, what I've just said about 1918 in context there. And then again in the Second World War, we've got the Blitz in Britain, in London, provincial cities, England, Scotland. Eventually the tide turns and there's some, and the bombing of Germany starts. Now that's a controversial subject and it's worth a broadcast in its own right, but you might have thought that after years of watching London suffer, it would have been difficult not to be human and come out, having watched this film of the bombing in the private cinema at his country house. You might have thought he'd come out and say, ha ha, the boot is on the other foot, the tide has turned. Far from it, he came out, the lights came up, he came out and the tears were pouring down his face. And he said, have we become such beasts? So he had this capacity for identifying with the underdog. Pretty amazing given his social background, but there you are. So shall we talk a little bit about
let's talk about India, because you know, as we're establishing, India does seem to be an exception rather than a rule. He seems to have from the very beginning a different mindset about the country, the continent, the people, the culture, everything.
Yeah, exactly. And this is what I found difficult to reconcile, these two sides of him. But I mean, taking the 1930 to 35 period, it starts off with the government, first of all, the Labour government and then the Conservative government, having a series of roundtable conferences in London to decide what to do about India. That gets nowhere, so the government decides, by this stage, still a Labour government, but very shortly after a Conservative government, decide they've got to legislate, and they come forward with this Government of India Act, which is designed to create a federal structure. Not altogether daft. Federal structures have been used in Canada and Australia. But it was a federal structure that was intended to lead towards some kind of self-government. I think it was been a pretty half-hearted self-government, but it was a slippery slope as far as Churchill was concerned. So he led a band of about 30 to 50 people in the Commons, backwoodsmen. And a huge, much bigger number in the Lords, and a much bigger still number in the country generally. A lot of people, for a lot of people, India mattered. And Churchill protracted the debates enormously. There was vote after vote after vote. They tried to waylay the government when the government weren't around. They tried to put in so many caveats and qualifications that the act wouldn't be workable. And in the event, the legislation went through, but Churchill wasn't worried because he said, we've got so many qualifications into this horrible legislation that it'll get nowhere. And what he was doing really was to set up three separate interests in India. to divide and rule, as Gandhi said, quite rightly. They were the princes who indirectly controlled the bulk of India, and the Muslims and the Hindus. Churchill felt that these three elements were so mutually exclusive that nothing was going to happen as a result of the act. And in 1939, not yet Prime Minister, but First Lord of the Admiralty, he was able to say in Cabinet, "We have constructed a tripos," he called it, a three-legged stool on which we may sit indefinitely. And this was, for him, this was wonderful. This is, in reality, it was a complete frustration, thwarting of India's legitimate interests, but he triumphed in it. He thought this was great. And he added a fourth element to the three legs of the stool. He also said he was concerned about what were called in those days the untouchables, we now call the Dalits. And actually here, I mean, I'm very critical in this book of Churchill, but actually I think in relation to the Dalits, he probably was genuine. I don't think they were just another element to divide and thus to rule. I think again, we come back here to the ordinary mass of humanity. He saw the politicians as an elite moneyed class, a mercantile class, which he didn't appeal to him. And I think he thought that he was protecting the real India, the agricultural India, the India of the millions and millions of Dalits. And there I would exonerate him. I think he was quite honest about that. But the other elements, he certainly wasn't honest about. He created his three-leg stool and he intended to sit on it. And there's some evidence that during the debates on the India Act, he was in touch with the princes. The princes initially had been in favor of the act and of the federation, the federal system. But gradually they came to see risks for themselves. And so before the act was completed, they came back and said, yeah, we don't want this act either. We don't like this. And Churchill, interestingly, knew that before the government did. So he was clearly in touch with and working with the princely interests. And there he had it. Then he'd, by the end of the legislation, the act was pretty well emasculated. And we could move, if you like, Paul, to the war years.
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
A big subject there, and I think maybe we can look at it in more detail in relation to questions, but just broadly the picture was that the three-leg stool was in existence. He thought that the war was no time to be changing policy, and that India would there'd be a state of stasis throughout the war. And he was assisted in this by the fact that the then Viceroy, Lord Linlithgow, was an equally stubborn, obstinate, conservative man. And he took the same view that you batten down the hatches and get on through the war without rushing into political novelties and taking any risks. Things didn't work out like that because the Japanese invade. India becomes not an adjunct to the war, as had appeared to be the case, but it becomes a central part of India, of the war, I should say. So Singapore falls in February 42, and a month later, the Rangoon is approached by the Japanese. Churchill realized that he had to do something to appease Indian opinion and also to appease Roosevelt, who was very supportive of Indians' aspirations. Roosevelt, I always feel a bit two-faced about this. He was busy extending the American empire and the American sphere of influence, but he had very little sympathy for the British empire. So there were initiatives. Churchill made an offer of 1940, the August offer it was called, which was a kind of vague idea that after the war, things could improve, there'd be changes would be made. Didn't cut much ice. 42 Sir Stafford Cripps, Churchill's nearest rival, Labour MP, but in the opinion polls, the man threatened Churchill most. He took a great interest in India, and he went out on the Cripps mission, 1942, taking with him no one really quite new, but he was certainly taking the August offer again. And it was a kind of promise that there would be a constitutional government for India at the end of the war. And Gandhi or Nehru, I've never been quite sure who said it first, famously described it as a post-dated check drawn on a crashing bank. So the Hindus in particular never bought into the Cripps mission. Churchill, meanwhile, was politicking behind Cripps's back. He was much in touch with Linlithgow, still the viceroy, and he's telling, he's sharing every secret with Linlithgow and keeping Cripps out of the loop. So the Cripps mission failed. In some ways, because of a certain stubbornness about on the part of the Hindus, who wanted a much more cut and dried offer rather than the slightly vague terms that Cripps was allowed to carry. But it failed anyway because Churchill was busy politicking against Cripps all the time. And after about 3 weeks, Cripps telegraphs back to Churchill and says, it's not going to work. I'm going to come home. Churchill says rather cynically in his war memoirs, I was able to accept this news, which I had always expected, with a degree of equanimity and philosophy. So as far as he was concerned, it was an exercise that had to be gone through in order to keep the Americans happy and perhaps get India a bit more on side as far as the war was concerned. But it wasn't something he expected to work. He certainly didn't want it to work. And that really was the failure of the Cripps mission. That was the failure of any serious attempt before Churchill surrendered the seals of office in 1945 to create an independent India. So that's the broad overview. Question which you are going to ask me, Paul, I suppose, is why was India different?
Yeah. Obviously accepting the fact that there aren't any absolute definitive answers to that, because it is complex, and his relationship evolves and changes through his own desires and also his pressures to, as you just explained there, he's got to bring, to some extent, the Indian people on his side. 2.5 million Indians served with Allied forces in World War II. So it's an evolving relationship. But what led? Yeah, let's hear your conclusions or your theories.
Well, it's not a very subtle or sophisticated theory, but it's the same. You know, I was saying a moment or two ago that there was a great deal of support for Dyer shooting innocent civilians, and there was a great deal of support for Churchill and the various leagues that were set up to try to sabotage the India Act. There were a lot of rank-and-file conservatives in the counties who shared the same view as Churchill, I think, and that is that India made Britain special. It made the British Empire an empire. The British Empire, people used the phrase empire and imperialism and so on for some time before 1857, but it was only in 1857 when the East India Company is replaced as the ostensible ruler of India by Britain that Queen Victoria was made the Empress of India. And so when George VI, her grandson, was writing to his mother, Queen Mary, in 1947, immediately after the granting of independence, he'd normally, it seems pretty strange to us, but he'd normally signed off to, when he was writing to Mummy, with R, Ind Imp, Rex, and Emperor of India. Very formal way of writing to your mother, I thought, but for the first time, that first letter after independence, he had to limit himself to putting R for Rex under his name because he no longer was the Emperor of India. And without India, Churchill thought Britain would be a very poor thing. I don't know if you've got listeners in Belgium, but they may not be pleased to know that he said without India, Britain would be no more than Belgium.
Oh, that's harsh.
That's a savage thing to say. but he'd said back in 1934, the loss of India would mark and consummate the downfall of the British Empire. That great organism would pass at a stroke out of life into history. From such a catastrophe, there could be no recovery. And that, I think, was, I mean, it sounds a sort of simplistic thing to say, but I think that really did matter. When India left the empire at the midnight night, as the midnight tryst that Nehru talked about, 3/4 of the subjects of the British Empire left the empire. So it was big. But it wasn't just that it was big. It was... there was something hugely romantic about India. It made Britain very special. He wasn't interested in Africa, wasn't, as we've heard, interested in Ireland. He wasn't interested in the Middle East. But India, the allure, the romance of India, the colours, the spices. And remember, he had been there. He knew, yeah. he'd seen it. This just made India something different from any other part of the empire, and thus the removal of this crucial, this identifying feature meant the end of everything that made Britain special. And he was very afraid of that. He started, you know, at the examples I've given of his liberalism are largely from his earlier years. Like many people, he moved to the right as he got older. He was horrified by the growth of communism. He's seen the great empires of his youth, the German Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, the Russian Empire. He's seen them disappear. And he was what was called a neo-Darwinian. He believed, as many, many, many people did in those days, that nations were like human beings or species of animals. They either fought, shed blood, thrived, and moved forward, or they disappeared. They were jettisoned in the march forward. A lot of people believe this, and Churchill was one of them. So he saw the inclination to shed India as part of this process of national decline. And he was quite clear that if we started on that route, we would end up as a very unimportant, irrelevant little offshore island. And, you know, to be devil's advocate, maybe he was right. Britain is a very different nation from what it was then. And I think many of us will think, and we're much the better for it. But by his lights, it was a different process altogether.
But this is where it gets complicated, because you've almost made that sound romantic, you know, that the Indian Empire is part of the British Empire, but as like a partnership, as like on equal footings, we're moving forward, more like the kind of a modern Commonwealth in some ways. But there would be others watching this who would say that, no, he had a completely, well, racist is the word, and a view of India as very much subservience and there to provide for the British at a junior level. And I'm being complimentary with a junior level. So that's where it gets a bit complicated, isn't it? Because a partnership is very different to being a junior too.
Yeah, I don't think he saw it as any kind of partnership. He India was there to enhance British prestige and perhaps to contribute to British prosperity. I don't make too much of that. India had enormously contributed to British prosperity. We raped India. We took all her resources. We killed the native cotton industry, took their raw cotton to Britain and then exported it again. The money that we made from this was injected into the slave trade in the West Indies. It was a deplorable period. I think by the time you get to the 30s, India was probably costing more for us to maintain than we're getting out of it. But, you know, having said that, there were lobbies. The Lancashire cotton industry lobbied strongly at the time of the 1935 Act, because they were afraid that if India got some kind of independence, India would put tariffs on cotton goods that were being exported from Britain. So the financial interest is there, but I think it's a bit simplistic to overemphasize it too much. But it certainly wasn't any partnership of equals, and he didn't imagine that. He could do in other cases. I devote a chapter of the book to Churchill's language. And he said terrible things. He said that Indians are a hateful people with a hateful religion. He used a lot of language I haven't even felt able to put into the book. It's just so unacceptable nowadays. All I would say is that he was a creature of his time, and his times were really quite far back. I mean, he was Victorian. When he was first in the army.
We think of the World War II era as having a different perspective, an old-fashioned perspective, possibly. But as you just said, he was old for World War II, let alone 2024.
Yeah, I mean, even in World War I, in some of his letters, he's describing himself to Clemmie as being kind of on his last legs. His father had died very young. Churchill was convinced for some reason that he too would die very young. So even in 1917, he thought he was a pretty old man whose time was pretty well finished. So, you know, he did belong to a different age. So he said some awful things, but he said awful things about other races as well. He said some bad things, very bad things about Jews. He made jokes about Jews. But a disproportionate number of his closest friends were Jewish. He had great sympathy for the Jewish nation. He was a Zionist. He identified, and actually this is a form of racism, really, because he identified the Jewish race as being up near the top in the kind of hierarchy of races that he recognized. And his name is on the Wall of the Righteous amongst the nations in Jerusalem. He was such a staunch friend of Jews. So take his some of these awful remarks with a pinch of salt. But there's no doubt that he did regard, he saw a hierarchy of races. He talked about the Anglo-American race, the English-speaking races. He even used that for, as you know, for one of his series of books. So I think he thought the Anglo-Saxons were pretty good. I think he probably thought the Germans were pretty good. And he specifically identified the Jews as being a race with very special qualities. I don't think he saw that in India at all. Although a distinction has to be made. He fought in the Northwest frontier. He fought alongside Sikhs and Muslims, and he talked about them as the hardy mountain people, as opposed to the effete moneylenders and box wallers of the plain. So there's a distinction between the soft mercantile Hindu classes and the warlike people. It's a bit like the distinction between the kilted Highlander from the north of Scotland and the fat lazy people in the lowlands of Scotland, where I happen to come from, so I can say that without upsetting anyone, I hope. But so he drew a distinction, but on the whole, he he just didn't begin to think that India was remotely capable of self-government in 1945.
So we'll, I want to get to a little bit about partition. We've got a couple of questions about Mountbatten, but before we do that, the elephant in the room is the Bengal famine, is that whenever Churchill in India comes up, it follows that he gets accused at varying levels of causing that distrust or not responding to that famine properly. And so what's your reaction to the Bengal famine?
Well, I'm no friend of Churchill in relation to India. That will be clear from the book and some of my, well, one in particular of my right-wing critics takes me to task very much on that, although I'm glad to say that others have found the book rewarding. But I don't think the biggest charge against Churchill is the Bengal famine. I'm looking as everyone else is at that awful picture, and I'm not for a moment minimizing how terrible the famine was. The question is, first of all, did he cause it? Well, I think we can agree he didn't cause the famine.
Yeah.
It was a natural phenomenon. It was exacerbated by merchants who profiteered, who hoarded grain and tried to sell it at exorbitant prices. It was also exacerbated by local politicians in Bengal who didn't really rise to the level of events. But Churchill was the prime minister. You did the buck stop with him. There was a famine. He was prime minister. Is that all there is to it? I don't think so. I think that's too simplistic. Churchill was one of a cabinet. A cabinet government is not a one-man government, even in the first, well, I'm going to say even in the Second World War, but particularly in the Second World War. Churchill's position, we tend to forget this, was quite weak. He was not popular with the Conservative Party. He only got there with the support of the Labour Party. There were others in the Conservatives who were hoping that Chamberlain would come back or that someone else would succeed him. Briefly, in 1940, after Alamein, really, after the tide starts to turn, he has a brief period when he is more or less invincible, but it didn't last for long. And by the end of the war, he was facing a lot of criticism from his own backbenches. And there were people who were prepared to topple him at any time. So to think he had absolute power really at any time in the war is not good history, and it's arrived at to some extent through a kind of hindsight. There were others in the cabinet who had more responsibility for dealing with Bengal than he did. The Minister for Supply was a man called Lord Leathers, and he more than anyone else was the one who decided that the available, such food as was available, should not necessarily go to Bengal. I would have hated to have Leathers' responsibilities. The war was far from won at that stage. There were critical events going on in Greece and the Eastern Mediterranean. And Leathers had to decide where this limited supply of grain should go. And he wasn't alone in saying that priority had to be given to the areas in which the war would be won or lost. And remember, it could have been lost, even at that stage in the war, 42, 43, very easy for Britain and the Allies to have lost. Mm-hmm. And Leathers wasn't the only one. Lord Charwell, for instance, took the same view. Lord Beaverbrook took the same view. Churchill created a number of sticks for his own back there, because in cabinet he said again some awful things about India. For instance, the one that's remembered, The Bengalis are already starving. Is it not better that the food should go to sturdy Greeks? Said a number of things like that, which are awful and don't help his reputation when they're remembered now. In cabinet, the Secretary of State for India was a man called Leo Amery, who was a kind of pretty self-satisfied little man. And Churchill worked in cabinet throughout the war, throughout his time in government, whether in the war or not, by a kind of dialectical approach. He liked to stir up argument, annoy people by putting an extreme position, testing their arguments. And he particularly got a great buzz out of annoying Amory by saying these awful things. Question is, did this matter? And I think it probably didn't. I think the most telling thing here is what Indian historians have said. And the Professor Roy and Amartya Sen have really exonerated Churchill on this. If I can quote Roy, he says, there is little evidence that Churchill's personal views about Indians influenced the policies of the war cabinet. I don't want to read too much. Churchill's reactionary views on the empire notwithstanding, the context for almost everything that he said about Indians and the empire was related to the Indian nationalist movement. What has any of that to do with the famine? The war cabinet did not divert enough ships from the theatres of war to Bengal or order India to divert any rations to feed people. Was it culpable? Professor Roy and Amartya Sen think that that Churchill wasn't culpable. He did manage to get substantial volumes of food diverted from Australia and Canada. And he appealed to Roosevelt, the Indians' champion, the one who was always telling Churchill that Churchill should be doing more for India. He appealed to him, and Roosevelt, despite his interference in British policy on India, Roosevelt came back and said, I'm really sorry, I would like to, but we just haven't got resources for everywhere. So, you know, you blame Churchill for recognizing the exigencies of war, then you have to blame Roosevelt as well.
Mm. Yeah, very good point. And we've discussed it time and time again on this channel. Shipping is in short supply. Even in 44 after Anzio, there's not enough ships. Whenever you have to provide ships for something, you're rubbing Peter to pay Paul. And in 42 and 43, there's even less shipping. We don't really solve the shipping problem until 45. So that's a thank you for expanding on that. Before we will bring things from, we have got a couple of questions about Mountbatten, and we, you know, there are other figures who loom large in India's history as well as Churchill. So two representative questions. Neil Murray is saying, this is about 45, I think, so did Mountbatten torpedo Churchill? And then Grant Dunn is saying, what is Walter's view of Lord Mountbatten's role and achievements? So what's the Walter Reed feeling about Mountbatten and Churchill in India?
Well, Mountbatten followed Wavell as viceroy. Wavell followed Linlithgow, whom I've spoken about. And Wavell, to my mind, was a very good viceroy. He was, you might have thought, a military man. You might have thought he would be unresponsive to Indian demands and aspirations. But he didn't. Before he came out to India at all, he spent quite a lot of time doing his homework in the India office in London. And he came away saying, we've been lying to these people. We've been making promises that we can't deliver on. And when he got to India, he did as a good soldier should do. He made an appraisal of the situation. He looked at the facts, not his own prejudice, but the facts. And he said that we got there too late if we were hoping to get India into independence on a peaceful and smooth and comfortable way. That would have taken a generation, 30 years, he said, building up a middle class, creating the institutions for independence. Till then, and this runs throughout the earlier period that I dealt with in the other book, people are looking at India and trying to envisage some way in which independence could come and India would become like one of the home counties overnight. No violence, everything peaceful and civilized and happy. And that, I mean, realistically, that wasn't ever going to happen, and it didn't happen. If 30 years had been devoted to preparing the institutions, preparing a commercial middle class, might have been possible. So Wavell comes out and he says the only way we can get out of here with any hint of peacefulness is to withdraw pretty fast, fix the date, and come out by it. This was not popular with Churchill, obviously, or with Churchill's successor. 1945, Churchill comes out of office and Attlee comes in. And Attlee is a keen, Attlee, Labour Prime Minister, has taken an interest in India from a very early stage in his career. He was out as part of the Simon Commission in 1928. He worked quite closely with Indian politicians. He was quite friendly at a personal level. But he didn't like this idea, this policy of scuttle, as it was called. And Wavell had a rotten time. He had a very, very poor support from Churchill or from Attlee. He was there more under Attlee than under Churchill. And he was pretty well ignored. And one occasion he came back to London for consultations and the cabinet didn't even ask him to come along for 3 weeks. When he wrote to a friend one time and said, we went as a family to a news theatre today. We had to queue up for a long time, but eventually we did get in, which is more than can be said for getting to see the cabinet. They actually didn't want to see him, didn't want to know what he had to say. And it was Attlee who appointed Mountbatten. Mountbatten comes out and fairly quickly comes to exactly the same conclusion as Wavell had done. A date has to be fixed. So he fixes a date in 1948. Then he sees the intercommunal violence getting worse and worse, and he can see very clearly the sort of results there will be in the event of partition, and partition is accepted as far as Mountbatten is concerned. For the first time, that becomes government policy. So he brings the date of departure forward by a whole year from 1948 to 1947. And the plan, the departure plan that he implements is really Wavell's plan. They dusted it down and implemented it. And it was scuttle. It was done very, very fast. We'll never know whether more or less violence would have occurred if we had waited. I suspect it would have been more, not less. I think Mountbatten read that correctly. But it was done at enormous haste. As you know, the Radcliffe Commission, the civil servant John Radcliffe, who came out to draw up the boundary line, he had 6 weeks to do that in a country the size of the subcontinent. And it involved splitting communities or splitting our community from its source of water or from its railway station. It was very crudely done. It would have been even cruder if they didn't have Wavell's draft plans, because he had started work on this while he was still there, and Mountbatten made some use of that. So my view on Mountbatten, he was a wonderful showman. I think he was a showman and a show-off. Meretricious is the word I would use for him. He was wonderful with people. He recognized, I suppose, the inevitable that we were going to have to get out, that we were going to have partition and the evils, the killing that would follow on partition. I think that what he didn't want, he said as much later when he got back to London and the killing was going on. He said, well, at least it didn't happen under my watch. Incredibly vain and ambitious and in some ways superficial man. And I think it mattered more to him that he wasn't too much associated with what happened. And that was why he hurried it forward and then scampered. The other question, Paul, was did Mountbatten scupper Churchill? Was that the...
Torpedo Churchill was a specific phrase.
Well, I think what I've said probably expresses my view.
I think you've answered that. Thank you. Yeah, no, brilliant stuff. And just a couple of questions before we end. And well, the first is a comment about Japan's culpability in the Bengal famine. Going back there, he says losing Burma didn't help. Neither did Japanese submarines in the Bay of Bengal. I don't need to see much discussion about Japan's role in causing a famine. When blame is assigned, it's always the British. And it's a good point in many ways that it was the Japanese invasion that creates the situation where there's a need for supplies elsewhere. So which brings me to ask you.
Just to say what a very good point that is. It's bang on. I suppose you can say if Hitler hadn't started the war, it would have been fine too. But yeah.
My last question really is about this idea that Churchill looms very large in the Indian story, clearly, but there are other figures. I mean, the fact you brought Attlee in there is important, and you know, for future generations in the historiography. To really understand India's history and how Britain's involvement with the history is nuanced, will we need to widen the field a bit and not just think about Churchill? Or do you think that we're stuck with the fact that as there are 2,000 Churchill biographies, it's always going to be viewed through the lens of Churchill?
I think that's probably a British preoccupation. Churchill was voted the greatest Briton ever in whatever it was, 1970 or something. It's an unhealthy fact that Britain tends to see her role as defined by the Second World War. And I don't want to be too political, but I think Brexit had quite a lot to do, or the Second World War had quite a lot to do with Brexit. An idea of putting us back to some glorious age which never quite existed. And in some ways, Churchill is a symbol of that. I mean, he was a great man, there's no question. The grandeur of his concepts of humanity, as I've mentioned earlier, he's got to be recognized as a great man. And he was a symbol of a great period in British history, which is now past. He'll matter to us a lot. My generation, dare I say, your generation, Paul, you're a lot younger than me, but I think it'll be difficult. I think he'll always, for our generation, he'll always be the man who won the war, the man who made these wonderful speeches. We'll associate him with these black and white movies we watched when we were kids. I think that tide is turning. You know, these British people in Britain who are daubing his statue, who are writing him off as my children, grandchildren probably would do, as a racist. I think the lens through which he is seen is changing in Britain. But I think in India, I mean, your Indian listeners obviously far better qualified than me to say this, but I don't think he's that important in Indian history, unless you're a very nationalist historian looking at perhaps the events of the famine. The first time I went to India, I had family who worked there. My wife's grandfather was the governor of Bihar and Orissa. We tended to look at India through the British prism. When I got there, I found that people really didn't link Britain with India in the way we linked Britain with India. They thought of the Mughals, they thought of the French, other imperial powers, they thought of the British too, but just as amongst them. And actually, a lot of people said, and now we've got these super rich multimillionaires who are, in an undemocratic way, are now ruling India. And this is yet another period of imperialism, imperialism by Indians this time, not by foreigners. But I think we can take ourselves too seriously in relation to India. We went there and we love going back there. It's a wonderful country and wonderful people. But India is more important to us than we are to India, I think. They're a vibrant community and a very young community. And I doubt if they dwell much on Churchill or on Warren Hastings or Clive of India. I think they're thinking much more of what's happening now and what will be happening in the exciting century that lies ahead for them.
Well, that I couldn't end this show any better than what you just said there. It's we Brits do have a maybe an overinflated idea of our own importance, and World War II continues to drive, well, my YouTube channel and many other people's podcasts and YouTube channels. And for some people, it's not quite as important as other things. So it's been an incredibly insightful conversation, Walter. I'm thinking of another. I'll invite you back in the future to expand on this, because I feel we didn't. There's lots more we could have talked about. But in the meantime, viewers, I urge you to go and get Walter's book. You can either buy it from the links in the description below, or your any whatever bookstop shop is your favorite. And I'll see you again next time. We're continuing with Burma tomorrow. Norma Graham is on talking about Royal Canadian Air Force supply units, and we've got Mike Bechtold on later in the week talking about the 100th anniversary of the Royal Canadian Air Force. We've got Jack Boucher on talking about tanks in Burma, and we've got a show about Saipan. So thank you, everybody, for your fantastic question. The sidebar was very lively. Thank you, Walter, and I will see you all again tomorrow. Did you enjoy it, Walter?
I hugely enjoyed it. It's very stimulating. I'd love to come back.
Brilliant. We'll see you again. And thanks, everybody. See you tomorrow. Bye.
Bye-bye.